So guys, today I'm going to be doing a video on what to bring when hiking, or what to bring to have a good and enjoyable hike. With spring now officially here and hiking gaining in popularity because hiking is awesome, today I'm going to be showing you guys what to bring on a day hike and how to be prepared for an enjoyable day hike. Day hikes are really a great form of getting out into the woods, getting some fresh air into you, and I love doing day hikes. In fact, I do a ton of them during the summer, and that's how I get a lot of awesome footage, pictures, and just scenery of the great Alaska that I live in. So I thought today I would go over some of the things I've learned and how I prepare for a day hike. Starting off, and this may sound funny because generally day hikes are pretty quick, you know, you're not doing a whole lot of work, but the most important thing about a day hike, just like any hike, is before you go out to not only dress accordingly, but know where you're going. If you don't know where you're going and you're hiking with a group of people, make sure to ask those people, you know, where are they going? What are the conditions like? How far are they going? You know, overall, the types of questions that you'll be able to know how to dress accordingly. And if they don't know those types of questions, it'll be a really good prerequisite to say that maybe you shouldn't be going on a hike with those individuals, because if they don't know what they're up to, the chances are it'll be the blind leading the blind, and that is a very good condition for a survival situation, which we try and avoid even as survivalists. So definitely try and avoid people who don't know that. And another great thing to do if you want to go to a hike, like there are some domes out here that I don't frequent as often, but I'm a part of a lot of interior Alaska hiking groups, and so what I'll do with my friends is if say I want to hike a particular dome, I'll go these groups or these forums and ask, you know, I want to go to Wickersham Dome. What are the snow conditions like? Or, you know, who is the last person to hike it? Do they have pictures? Can they tell me anything about that particular area? Because especially in the spring and in the late fall or early spring and late fall, you know, I don't know what the snow loads are, but they do vary quite frequently. And depending on each year, it's not the same. So it's very important to know and to ask those types of questions. And like I said, sometimes it even takes you being a part of a group on Facebook and just asking questions to people who do like to snowshoe or whatever. So a lot of it is just in the preparation and knowing about what you're getting yourself into before you get putting such a heavy emphasis or stress on this particular thing, is because the next part is knowing how to dress. This is something that I had to learn the hard way, especially up here in the interior Alaska. A lot of the good trails lead up to domes, mountains, or hills, and so up at the top of those domes, mountains, and hills, it's all extremely windy, and it's actually very barren up there, or at least on most of them. So something that I learned the hard way was you have to learn to account for that and be wearing something like this windbreaker, because up there, I've been lucky a handful of times where there's been no wind, but most times the wind ranges from anywhere from 30 to 70 miles an hour. And if you don't believe in wind chill, go up there not properly dressed and you will believe in wind chill, because it is insane up there. And once again, with there being very little cover, there's really no place for you to duck out of the wind. So you'll really learn a big lesson in dressing properly. And that was something that I learned a little bit of the hard way. Luckily it didn't kill me, but I learned the hard way is making sure that you understand where you're going and how to account for that, because not every trail here leads up to the top of a mountain or a hill or a dome, so you don't always need a windbreaker. But making sure you know just how far you're going up, or you know that you're going to the top of a dome, make sure you'd want to grab something like this windbreaker. Or if you know that you're going into rainy conditions, making sure that you have something like a rain fly or a jacket that's very lightweight but rain resistant, just so that you can continue to have fun. Because that's the primary thing about a day hike, is you want it to be enjoyable, you want it to be fun, and that's what will continue to motivate you to continue to do day hikes. So that's the biggest thing, is you know, making sure that you wear something for your conditions. Another thing here is making sure you wear proper things like pants. And these pants, or Carhartts in particular, the reason why I've really sworn by Carhartts is because a lot of them, like these ones in particular here, they have double fronts, or if I can show it, they're dumping all this gear, but they have double fronts here, and I can't tell you guys how many times this has saved my butt, because we all understand, we all make mistakes, we all fall down and get scrapes and whatever, but if you can understand that you're going to make those mistakes and fall down, you can learn to account for that by wearing good clothing that has double layers like this. And like I said, this has saved me from getting scrapes, cuts, bruises many times. And what I actually really like about the Carhartts is you guys can see there's this little hole here, or hopefully you guys can see there's like this little hole here. And what you can do is you can put pads in here, and those pads will once again help that if you stumble or you fall down and land on your knees, those pads will take the blow. And that is something that's really nice. And that can actually prevent you from needing to go to your medical kit that you have hopefully on you, or you know, it'll save you from needing to get a Band-Aid to put on you. So having the dressing properly is a big, big deal, at least in my opinion. And like I said, understanding that to dress properly will save you so much time and so much pain, effort, energy in the long run. So do dress properly. And ultimately, what I would say for recommendations on dressing properly is make sure that you're properly covered from your elements and your insects. And so that is, you know, whether it be snow, wind, you know, rocks falling and possibly hurting yourself, but also be prepared for things like insects. I know up here in Alaska, as I've mentioned in other videos before, insects like mosquitoes are a huge deal. And that's another thing that can really make hiking and day hiking really suck. If you aren't prepared for mosquitoes, they will bite you up relentlessly. They don't care who you are or what you're wearing, whatever, regardless to anything, they will attack you ruthlessly. And so having all of your body covered, at least in some light form, can really cut down on mosquito bites and overall annoyance of mosquitoes. Another one that can happen year by year, it can be worse in some years, is, you know, things like hornets and wasps. Sometimes, you know, they're natural animals, so sometimes they'll build their nests right on your trail. So you have to learn to account for that. And once again, the last thing you want to do is get stung while you're on like a 5 mile hike, because that can really suck. Real observant
people, you'll probably notice that this is actually being filmed on another day. That is because this part of the video was actually somehow messed up. I got like the recording, the time that I was recording and the time that I was talking off, so that got entirely messed up. So I'm gonna have to redo
now to get into the backpack. So a few notes before we really dig into this backpack. The first thing I wanted to note was that I left this backpack not super stuffed, just so that you guys would have an idea of the essentials to what you really should be carrying, but you also still have room to put your essentials in here. Another big thing is to factor with day hikes and having a fun day hike is to make sure that your proper medical needs are addressed. And what I mean by this is if you have things like asthma or allergies to pollen or something like that, do address those. So if you know that you may have asthma problems, bring an inhaler. If you know you may have allergy problems, bring eye drops or whatever you need to help combat your allergy. So that will really assist you in not only having a non-life threatening hike, but it'll also help you to have a fun hike. The big reasons why I left like room still in this setup. Of course, I also want to mention the pack I'm using, and I'll leave a Amazon link in the description below in case you would like to get this pack for day hiking. But this is the Maxpedition Jumbo Versa pack. But things like this area up here are left completely empty, so you could potentially put medicines or whatever you need to carry for a personal reason up in like a place like this. So now getting into the pack contents. Any of my other videos, you'll know that I really like to go over the outsides. So that's exactly what I'm gonna do with this one. So also keep in mind that I've been a woodsman hiker for a few years now. So if you see my gear is quite upgraded, don't feel like you need to get the exact gear that I'm using, because I've used things like plastic bottles for years with high success. So this first pouch here is of course carrying my water bottle, and my water bottle for this pack
is a stainless steel 38 ounce Nalgene. I'm also having it sit in a GSI Glacier, which you guys can't really see from this angle, but there's a GSI Glacier stainless steel cup in here. And while I wouldn't necessarily say that you need a stainless steel bottle, it is very nice if you can get one, because they do tend to carry more water. They're also one of the big things for survival is you can take any water and boil it in here. So that means that if you have to stay out longer than you expect, you can still refill at things like ponds, streams.
You can still boil
that pond water in here and make drinkable water. However, like I said, one setup I ran for a long time was a plastic Nalgene with a GSI Glacier, and so I would always try and make sure that you just have some cup or bottle that you can boil water with for the survival aspect. But like I said, you don't necessarily have to go for a stainless steel bottle, but I would recommend a stainless steel nesting cup, just for that fact that, you know, while you can't boil with the plastic bottle, you can still boil with the stainless steel cup, and that gives you something as opposed to nothing, and that will at least allow you to boil a little bit of water. So that is the first.
So the next thing here, and it's definitely not a necessity, but it is the multi-tool, and this is just a Leatherman Surge. Wave might be better budget option, same with a Super Tool 300, but overall multi-tools are just a really great thing to have. They cover a plethora of different tasks you might have to be faced with in a hiking situation. Very good. If you're looking for an upper end hiking multi-tool, I'd probably recommend a Charge TTI, because they're super lightweight but super durable. But that is what I'm carrying. I'm just carrying Leatherman Surge in this pouch with a malice clip on the outside of this other pouch that I'll get into in a little bit. So then the next thing that's external, and really the last thing that's external, well, I guess that's the stuff up front, but I have a nice fixed blade here. I would always recommend a fixed blade. This one, once again, is probably a little bit out of the price range, as this is like $150, but if you do want the Allegheny M38, which this is what this is, it's a great knife. I would highly recommend it, but if you don't have quite the $150 budget for a knife fixed blade for your hiking situations, more a companion clipper, even things like the Eldris make a great fixed blade companion for hiking, but that's what I'm personally running in there. It's just an Allegheny M38. Overall, you do want some fixed blade. Once again, it can assist you in firecraft should you need to start a fire. It can also help you in processing down food, opening like different food bags, like if you're running a mountain house meal or something like that, this can help you cut that open. Just be an overall good camp task knife. So then I have this part that fell out, is a UST Wet Fire, and I have a Exotac Nano Striker XL in this pouch, and I have a couple ferro rods, this being one of them. The stress of this backpack is not on starting fires, but of course, once again, going back to the survival element of this backpack, a handful of elements to start a fire should you find yourself in a survival situation. And that's also why I threw the Wet Fire in here, in case, you know, all your chips are down and you need to get a flame off of your ferro rod. You know, the Wet Fire will work, once again, as the name implies, even when it's wet. So that is a very good option to have. And that's why that's all just right there in this really nice pouch. Into this back pouch back here, this one right here, or this one with this zipper. I am carrying a gun, and I understand not everyone in every country can carry a gun, and not everyone in the US either wants to or can, but I would always encourage and especially recommend it whenever it's possible, because primarily my big concern is I'm not that concerned about myself, but when I hike, especially on more public trails that are still out in the wilderness, I never know how other people are going to react to wildlife. And you know, things like charging bull moose are a very real thing, and once again, if people don't understand how to handle themselves around these types of animals, they can't. Here, of course, I'm just running a Glock 21 with a loaded mag for whatever happens, and I'm carrying that in here, and all that I'm carrying in here, once again, for whatever happens, if I need to take down a charging animal or whatever happens. Once again, I want this to be an enjoyable outing, but I also don't want this to turn into a bad outing for myself, you know, that I don't come back from. So I want some self-protection means. This is also good for survival, should you ever be stuck out there. This means that, you know, I not only have the food that's in this pack, but I also have a means of providing food for myself, should I need it, or anyone else
in a group if I'm hiking with a group. And that's primarily why I carry this, is for group protection, because most people aren't armed, so I need to be armed. So in this next pouch, and this is primarily why I went to this pouch first. So in this pouch here, I really only have just a magazine in here because I couldn't really find anything else that I wanted to throw in there. But I have a magazine in here, and I do want to note just a quick couple things about if you do decide to run a handgun. Of course, once you're running a handgun, make sure you can lawfully run a handgun. And secondly, the biggest point is definitely put this pack on before you hit the trail. Make sure that you can grab this. Once again, I'm a right-hander, so I set this handgun up in here so that I can grab it with my right hand very easily. And then with this mag, as you guys can see how it's oriented, I have it in here for my left hand. So if I need to reload, that's all I have to do. So I keep it and I practice. Make sure you can understand, you know, and know how to use it. Sure you are comfortable with your setup and carry, and you know, especially when it comes to charging animals, like especially a moose, every second counts. So make sure you know how to use your setup and whatever setup you have, and make sure you're quick with it, because like I said, you may legitimately only have 3 seconds to take down that animal before it hits you. So do keep that in mind and make sure that you are good and your setup is the way you need it to be in an emergency situation. With that talk out of the way, now let's actually begin to look at the bulk of this pack. So of course up here I have an empty, but what I would recommend putting in this small little pouch or any small little pouch is a field map. If you have a map of your area, try and put that in here. You know, make sure you have a good map of the location so that you know if your GPS goes down or if your phone goes down, you have a physical map and way of navigation. So now taking a look at this first pouch, I guess it's actually first pouch here. So the first thing I have with this little light whistle, and that's what this little yellow thing is. It's a whistle. Definitely make sure you have some type of signaling, because another thing that's really nice, once again, going back to the survival situation, should you be pinned in an area or should you fall into a little crevice or whatever happens, you know, you want to be able to make sure people can locate you when they need to locate you. So always make sure that you have something like a signaling mirror, but as well as a whistle, because you know, a signaling mirror is great, but it requires one, for someone to be looking directly at that mirror, and two, it requires the sunlight. You can be in a dark cave or in a little crevice, whatever, and still use a whistle to high effect. And once again, people don't have to be looking right at you to hear that whistle. They can just hear it from a distance and be like, okay, someone's over in that direction. So whistles are a very nice method to have for signaling should you ever get lost and need to be found. So the next thing I have in here is just some general first aid stuff. I have a few band-aids in here just for cuts and scrapes, whatever. And then I have a more intensive IFAC in here should I need to actually do anything serious. If anyone, once again, does get seriously scraped or if they get hurt, you know, in any situation, the IFAC is definitely here to help. And I would highly encourage having some sort of medical, just like having a knife or a gun, do have some sort of medical, because even if it's not as serious as something like this IFAC, you always want something that's a very nice and is able to treat a array of wounds, especially the more severe wounds, because if I get a cut or a scrape, I can still walk out of there. But if I sprain my ankle or if I get a gash in the side of my leg, I may not be able to walk out of there. So you want to make sure that you can have medical supplies that can take care of those types of things, and that you have the skill to make things like splints so that you can help either yourself or someone that does have a sprain or a broken leg or whatever to help get them out of there. So getting into this big pouch here, I don't have a whole lot in here, but I did try and cover at least the five C's of survivability with this kit. And that is very important, because you want to make sure that, you know, if you do or for whatever reason, if something does go bad, that you can survive at least 1 to 2 nights out there in the field. And so the first thing I have in here, it's kind of big, takes up a bit of room, but I still think it's very important. And of course, your mileage may vary on what exactly you want to have, but I've been really impressed by these grabber. These are what they call all-weather blankets, but it's essentially a tarp on one side and then a Mylar blanket on the other. And I really like having this for the whole fact that Mylar blanket is something you can wrap around yourself, heat yourself up, and at the same time, you still have this tough and durable coating on the outside. You also have grommets on it, so you can string this up and use it as an emergency shelter should you need to. And of course, that is the cover part of the 5 C's. And of course, I've covered combustion and cutlery and container here, so I've pretty much covered all the 5 C's with that. And this also has some of the 10 C's as well. So once again, I have another ferro rod in here, just for whatever reason, in case the other one's lost. Ferro rods are small, they can get misplaced, so I like to have a little bit of redundancy when I can. So food is also another nice thing. When hiking, it is a given that you will be burning through quite a few calories. So having just a few simple like Kashi bars or, there's like supposed to be a Clif bar in here, okay. Or a Clif bar that I got misplaced in there. But, you know, having a few good pieces of food, you know, having a handful of bars because you use them on the hike, but they are definitely going to be nice should you have to stay overnight or for whatever happens. So the next few things I have in here, I have a few plastic bags. Once again, plastic bags are a great thing to have in case you need to put anything in a plastic bag. If you see something that you need to put in there, or if you need to put like any rings or anything you find in there, it's also nice, especially I know I like plastic bags for around fall when it's berry picking season. Something I love to do on the trail is pick a lot of berries, bring them home. You know, you can make jams, syrups with them. So it's really nice to have a few plastic bags. If not, nothing else, for the reason of just being able to pick berries with them. Another thing is a very basic compass. I know I get a lot of critiques. People want me to have more advanced compasses, but having a very basic compass is the least you should have. This will at least allow you to be able to, if you have a map, use your map and navigate. It'll also be able to, if nothing else, show you the direction in which facing you are. So if you do happen to know that civilization is south of whatever, you know, like hill you're hiking, you can be like, okay, at least I know to start moving toward that location or that direction. So it's very nice for that. It also allows you to walk in a straight line. If you know how to use a compass, it'll allow you to walk in a straight line and shoot straight points. And that's something that humans cannot naturally do when just hiking, you know, or just when walking, just with nothing around us. We do need something to help keep us pointed in a straight direction. If you guys don't know, you can read up more on that. But it is unfortunate we don't walk in straight lines, so you know it's nice to have a compass for at least pointing you in one direction. And once again, you do not need a super advanced compass to do that. Also, of course, I have cordage here. This is a real necessity. You know, I've never really had to use cordage while hiking, but it can be nice to string up your gear if, say, you want to put your backpack somewhere and you don't want it to be touched by anything. You can string it up, or of course, a survival situation, you can use it for many applications. Once again, working with it, with that survival blanket, you can use it to string up a shelter. The next part is a bandana. I've already talked a little bit in other videos about why I like to have bandanas for smoke. You know, if your season, or if the season just happens to be smoky and you get smoked out, it's very nice to have a bandana so that you can put that on and you can still breathe. I mean, it's not going to be clean air, but it's not going to be just straight smoky air. So that's very nice. It's also another important thing you need to realize: if you have anything like asthma, you need to have some preparations for any smoke. So the next thing I have in here, and this one's pretty tiny, but this is the Anova, I think it's the XS, or it's something. It's a really tiny Anova flashlight, but it's still very bright. This uses one AAA, and that's why I'm running it for this situation, is once again, it's tiny, it's lightweight, but it just runs on a very common battery, though. A single AAA is very basic, and you can have a bunch of them in here, but it still emits 110 lumens, as well as 12 lumens, that's two different modes, and I really like this for just a nice little night flashlight if you are caught in the dark. Generally in the summer, we don't really have to worry about darkness up here in Alaska, at least if you're outside, because it never really gets dark. But if you are hiking at any other time of the year, or if you're in the lower 48 where it does actually get dark during the night, having a nice flashlight to help keep you on your trail is a very, very nice thing to have. And once again, you can see this flashlight's tiny, it's lightweight, it doesn't take up that much room, so there's really no excuse not to have just some light source on your pack. So that pretty much makes it all up for me. Those are the basics. Keep in mind, I tried to keep this pretty open and empty so that you can add the things that you personally need for yourself. If there's anything that you like to have, you know, I don't wanna just jam pack this thing so full of the things that I want that it leaves nothing, no room for expansion. So I'm keeping this pretty open so that you can have room to play around with it. You can have room to add in things that you may need. Or things that you may want. So anyways, guys, hopefully you've enjoyed this quick look at what to bring when on a day hike. I know this kind of makes day hiking sound a little bit more complicated. You guys may have come to this video thinking, oh, you know, a day hike's really basic and simple. And it is true, you can just walk out and, you know, go out into the woods or, you know, hike on a trail without any of this stuff. You really don't need any of this. But if you want to be truly prepared for whatever eventuality happens, this is really the essentials you should have. And this is the stuff that in a survival situation or when things don't go as planned can really keep you alive. Anyways, guys, don't forget to comment, like, share, subscribe, and I'm out.